we have briefly understood about how electrons should behave. Okay. Now, in previous chapter, we have understood electron as a wave. Fine. In this chapter, we are treating electron as a particle. It's just a particle. It is moving in a circle. So once this electron was discovered and the atoms and everything, the model properly is in place, then more and more experiments were conducted to understand the exact behavior of the electrons. Fine. So do you know black body radiation? So if there is a black body, it will be able to absorb every wavelength that is falling on it, and should be emitting every wavelength possible. So if you draw a graph between energy for a particular wavelength, and that is, this is intensity and the wavelength, you'll get a graph like this. Are you getting it? So for a solid, every wavelength has some intensity. Almost every wavelength is present. Getting it? But for the gases, it is not like that. Okay? The issue with the solid is this, that the atoms are able to interact with each other. There is a potential energy also in place. So it is not just about a single atom. It is also about how one atom interacts with the other atom. There is a lattice in place, so there is a vibration. That vibration can also create a wavelength, right? So when you study solid, you can't say that this is the behavior of an atom, only atom. This is a collective behavior, how the atoms interact among themselves also, fine? But when you study gas, fine, we can ignore the force of attraction between the two atoms. You take it? Then whatever happens will be the atomic property, the behavior of the atom only. Getting it? So similar kind of spectrum was being studied on hydrogen gas. Okay? And the observation were completely different. So just like black body absorbs and emits every wavelength, similarly they were trying to see how what are wavelengths, or how the gas will absorb the wavelength and how gas will emit the wavelength. Okay. So since it is only because of the atoms when it comes to gas, we also call it atomic spectrum. Now, there are two kinds of atomic spectra, emission and absorption. Simple. Okay. So suppose you take a tube. You can take a transparent tube like this. Here, you put the gas. Okay. You put the hydrogen gas in it. And suppose you are passing multiple wavelengths through it. There are multiple wavelengths, all sorts of wavelengths. There is a range of wavelength between lambda 1 to, let us say, lambda 10. Okay, 10 wavelengths you have passed. Alright? So what is seen here is that only couple of wavelengths are able to come out. For example, from here, only, let's say, lambda 3, lambda 5 and lambda 7 comes out. Okay, the other wavelength get absorbed in the gas. Fine. And these wavelengths are not even absorbed, they are just rejected. Are you getting it? Fine. So this is for the hydrogen gas. So hydrogen gas, you pass lambda 1 to lambda 10, it absorbs lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 4, lambda 6, lambda 8, lambda 9, lambda 10. Fine. Suppose you replace hydrogen gas with nitrogen gas. Then it may absorb lambda 2, lambda 5, lambda 7, lambda 3, right? So there are different wavelengths each gas absorbs. And this should be the property of the atom. Getting it? This kind of behavior is not seen in a black body or any solid object. Whatever you throw on it, it will absorb. But gas doesn't. Getting it? Like for example, in photoelectric emission, we had different wavelength falling on the metallic surface, it will absorb all the wavelength. Electron may not be able to come out for all the wavelengths, but then it will absorb. So absorption spectrum for solid is straightforward. It absorbs everything that falls on it. Fine? Until unless it is like purely reflective surface or something like that. Okay? But the gas selectively absorbs. And one gas may absorb different wavelength, other gas may absorb some other wavelength. So this kind of spectra, the spectrum of wavelength it absorbs, it is called absorption spectra. Getting it? You can in fact plot a line like this, and these lines may represent what wavelength it is absorbing. You can say that wavelengths, this is an axis through which the wavelengths are changing. 1 angstrom, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 angstrom, like that. So this is like a barcode. Okay? These wavelengths, it will absorb. And every gas has a different type of barcode. Getting it? So that is the reason why this can be used as a signature of the gas. It's like signature of a gas. You can identify which gas is present by using this sort of setup. Fine. This is absorption spectrum. There is also something called emission spectrum, just like black body. Okay. The emission spectrum is like this. Suppose you give energy to it. By some means. Fine. So it will selectively absorb the wavelengths or photons, whatever it has to absorb, right? Then the gas will become excited. Fine. And after that, if you let it cool or if you let it do whatever it wants, then it will go to the ground state or it will de-excite. And when it de-excites, it will throw away some wavelengths in the form of photons. Fine. And when it is throwing away the wavelengths in terms of photon, they are also some selective wavelengths. They are not all the wavelengths possible. They are fixed. Fine. So this is emission spectrum. So there also is a barcode sort of thing. And this emission spectrum matches with absorption spectrum. So whatever wavelength it absorbs, similar wavelength or same wavelength it emits. Fine. This is the first observation when it comes to how atoms behave. Because study of gas will give you more insight towards the atomic behavior than study of a solid. Because every atom is independent in the gas. Fine. So this sort of experiment created a lot of issues. Like, you know, it was never expected that it will behave like this. Why it is selectively absorbing? Why it is selectively emitting? Fine. So people started asking questions. Fine. So for several years, there was no answer. There was no answer several years. But then during that time, people have systematically started to understand, okay, how this wavelength get emitted. What is a wavelength that get emitted? You know, is there any formula as such which they can? Have you ever derived a formula using graph? Y is equal to mx plus c, you used to fit the curve, right? So similar sort of thing people started to do. They know that what wavelength is coming out for what atoms. So they started plotting the graph and they started to see, what is the pattern? Can they derive some formula out of it without knowing why it is happening? Fine. So such kind of effort was going on because it was taking a lot of time for any explanation to come up. So let us talk about that now. Write down spectral series. Okay, so when the first when the first observation was made on spectral series, as in the different kinds of wavelength, the first, what kind of wavelength do you think will be getting observed? The visible wavelengths. Fine. So the person who have studied this particular wavelengths from the hydrogen atom, the name of that person is Balmer. Fine. Balmer was a school teacher. He had less access to any sophisticated machine or anything that can read the wavelengths which are beyond the visible spectrum. Fine. But then there was good enough instrument to actually detect what kind of visible spectrum wavelength is there in that school. So he studied that. That is why you call Balmer series. Okay. So what Balmer has done, he has found out a formula for the wavelength that will get absorbed or emitted in hydrogen gas. Getting it? Fine. In hydrogen gas, what are the wavelengths that get absorbed or emitted? That is what Balmer have derived. Balmer thought that he has derived all the wavelengths. Why? Because he could not observe other wavelengths other than the visible spectrum. Fine. So what Balmer has derived is this: 1 by lambda is a constant, 1 by 2 square minus 1 by n square, where n is greater than 2. It has to be greater than 2. Wavelength can't be negative. Getting it? The value of this constant, first of all, this is called Rydberg constant. RH is Rydberg constant, whose value is what?
109677.
Sure?
Yes.
Units? This is dimensionless. 1 by lambda is a unit of this, meter inverse. That's not correct. It is 1.097 into 10 to the power 7. Here you see 10 to the power 5 is coming.
This is
centimeter
inverse.
Yeah, centimeter inverse probably. Correct. So in physics, we are mostly dealing with the SI unit. So let's put it like this. 1.097 into 10 to the power 7. Meter inverse. This is what Balmer series. Why it is called series? I mean, is there any limit between which this Balmer's wavelength is bounded in? Is there a maximum wavelength or minimum wavelength for Balmer series? How will you find minimum wavelength? How will you find minimum? For minimum wavelength, 1 by lambda should be? If lambda is minimum, 1 by lambda should be maximum. And when 1 by lambda is maximum, the value of this should be maximum. And when this is maximum, when n is infinity. Okay, this is maximum when you don't subtract anything. This is anyway a positive quantity. The minimum value of this is 0 when n tends to infinity. So write down for lambda minimum, 1 by lambda should be maximum. It implies n tending to infinity. Okay, so you will get 1 by lambda minimum is equal to Rydberg constant divided by 4. Getting it? How will you find lambda maximum? What is the maximum possible wavelength? For lambda maximum, 1 by lambda should be minimum, and for that this should be minimum. And what is the minimum value of this? When you put n equal to 3, how will you put n equal to 1? This becomes negative, right? N should be greater than 2. So when you put n equal to 3, you'll get lambda maximum. So lambda maximum when n is equal to 3. So it has a limit between lambda minimum and lambda maximum. Balmer series lies. Getting it? Fine. This is Balmer series. So once Balmer has discovered these formulas, then there are other people also who have contributed. Okay? There are several people. Okay? This Lyman is there. Bracket, Pastern, Fund. Okay? For Lyman, now you can find out lambda minimum, lambda maximum for all the series. For Lyman, we have 1 by lambda equal to Rydberg constant multiplied by 1 by 1 square minus 1 by n square, where n is greater than 1. So this is Lyman. Then you have, what is this? 1 by 3 square minus 1 by n square. This is n greater than 3. This is what? Sure. This is Pastern. After Lyman, Balmer comes. Lyman, Balmer, Pastern, bracket, Fund. Lyman, Balmer, Pastern, write down. Then 1 by lambda, Rydberg constant, 1 by 4 square minus 1 by n square. This is bracket. And 1 by lambda, Rydberg constant, 1 by 5 square minus 1 by n square. This is fun. Fine. See, the thing is, the list can go on and on. You can have now n equal to 6, fine, but then after n equal to 5, you see that range shrinks between lambda minimum and maximum, so very few wavelength, okay, so that is why we stop at Fund, but n can go till infinity also. Now till now, all this is experimental stuff. People have done some experiment, came up with an observation using graph or something like that, they're able to come up with this expression. Okay? But nobody had till now, I mean not till now, that days, they have given any explanation to it. Fine? So Niels Bohr, who is like the father of quantum physics, he came up with the explanation of what is happening.